it.
If any institution could more readily come to stand for modern London than the Tube, then I have yet to think of it. Practical, egalitarian, efficient, popular, logical, organised, and yet infuriating, maddening, and confusing, it stands for everything modern life does in this great world capital. For most of my life, I've taken the Tube for granted. A huge resource that links me to my work, my friends, my entertainment, and to every facet of life in the city. It's the place the American werewolf romped unfettered. It's the station at midnight that Paul Weller immortalised. We're all in the army, Gary Newman enlisted, and we think of Jerry Rafferty as we rattle through Baker Street. We know those sliding doors. When you hear that distant rumble, it really is London calling. The Tube is the string that ties London and Londoners together. And I've come to the very end of the line to illustrate what I mean, to show the importance of the Underground to our history, our lives and our culture. This is just a small example of the many ways the Tube has played a really important part in the lives of Londoners. I'm here in Richmond. The leafy curve of the river and the languid pastures are about as far from the hustle and bustle of the city centre as you can get.
But it was precisely because of those reasons that a lot of the rock and pop music we've got today could be said to be born right here.
Just across from the Underground station is the site of the old Richmond Station Hotel. It was here that an unknown band, fronted by Mick Jagger, had their first professional gigs. And when they took off for the big time, they were replaced by the club's owner, Giorgio Gomelski, with Eric Clapton's group, The Yardbirds.
Back in 1963, this was the birthplace of the Stones, Eric Clapton and all that. Even the Beatles came here. But why did Giorgio choose here to put the Crawdaddy Club? Well, it's precisely because it was close to the Underground station and that the Underground station at Richmond was right at the end of the line, connected to London, but on the edge, a place for the rebels to congregate and in so doing, change London. And I suppose the world as well.
That Underground map has become the way Londoners see themselves and the city they live in. The Tube network changes with London. South London has always suffered from a lack of communication. Housing booms follow the growth of a new line. And after 150 years, the Underground is inextricably linked with the city it serves. In fact, if we go back 150 years, the reason for having an Underground at all stems from the fact that the world was changing for all Londoners, and changing really fast. During the 19th century, there was the unprecedented and rapid growth of Victorian London as the capital of the global empire. London was the first industrial power base and the epicentre of the modern world. Just look at how the population boomed. When James I came to the throne in 1603, London's population stood at just a little under 150,000 inhabitants, or about the same number that attends the Glastonbury Festival every year. The population returns of 1801, 113 years afterwards, put the figure at only 800,000. So slow, albeit steady growth.
But by the 19th century, all those piffling changes were forgotten about. In 1801, thanks to the census, we know that the population of London was about 750,000. But by the end of the century, it had swelled to a massive 6.7 million people living in London.
London swelled and rapidly assumed the role of the world's largest city. It just went ballistic. In 1851, the Great Exhibition, pretty much devised and produced by Prince Albert, showed the world just how far London had come. The result was a new phenomena, the day tripper. And what Prince Albert did next with the profits from the Great Exhibition cemented this social trend. With quite brilliant foresight, he created a new area of London, which became nicknamed Albertropolis. It was packed with great things to see on your day off. The Victoria and Albert Museum, the Albert Hall, the Science Museum, the Natural History Museum, all within a short hop of each other. No wonder there's a memorial to him. And he brought us the Christmas tree. What a royal!
So, by the mid-1850s, there are thousands of people living in slums in the centre of London. Thousands more on the outskirts, wanting to get into the middle of London for their work. And even more people all around the country aiming to travel into London to see the attractions that Prince Albert has given them in the centre of town. There needs to be a coherent transport system for London. And the answer for that, well, it's not going to be the horse.
Rush hour at King's Cross, one of the busiest stations on the network. Six different lines meet here. And of course, it also serves a major overground railway station. 70 million passengers pass through each year, but few realise the role the station played in giving London its underground system. The first steam railways had begun in 1825, and 25 years later, King's Cross was a major terminus for those steam trains arriving in London. But the railroads were not permitted to expand any further into London by Act of Parliament. This meant that the 750,000 travellers who arrived every day trying to get to work had to find a way of getting into the city.
London of the 1850s was one of the world's largest cities. It was a massively growing industrial city and a port, the hub of the start of the British Empire. Interestingly enough, it was a very dense and crowded city. It was still largely built on its medieval street pattern, and it meant that people basically jostled together. People lived very close to their work, and it was a very crowded city full of cobbled streets, gas lights and horse-drawn vehicles.
160 years ago, London was grinding to a halt, and it needed a solution to link the railway stations to the city centre. There was only one way to go, and that was underground.
I think it's important to remember that for most people, the thought of actually going underground and travelling at speed underground was actually a very novel concept. Many Victorian writers saw death and doom and destruction to people who actually travelled on underground railways.
Newspapers such as the Times actually ran quite a fierce campaign against the railway, saying that even if it worked, technically it would never pay because people would never use it. They were speculating about underground passages soaked with sewage drippings and infested by rats.
The solution was the vision of one man, Charles Pearson. He persuaded Londoners they needed a transport network beneath the streets. He knew that if people could get in and out of the city easily, they could live further away, and the slums would become a thing of the past.
Charles Pearson was a lawyer associated with the City of London, and he was the person who really first pressed for the building of the Metropolitan Railway, which was the world's first underground steam railway. And Pearson basically came up with the idea of digging a trench down the middle of the road, of roofing it over, and running his railway in the bottom of the trench.
The Metropolitan Railway Company broke ground in 1860. The building method used was called cut and cover and was a very expensive engineering project. It involved digging tunnels which were over 20 feet wide, laying two tracks side by side, and then bricking these over to replace the road. This project took 3 years to complete and caused havoc to homes and businesses. The new tunnels were very shallow and ran only feet below the road surface. An example of this can still be seen in Notting Hill. There are two dummy houses, numbers 23 and 24 Leinster Gardens, which are identical to all the other houses in the road, except for one thing. Their frontage is merely a wall, 5 foot thick, complete with painted doors and windows. They were built to fill the gap in the row of houses when the line was built through the street. The Metropolitan Line opened in January 1863, and it basically connected the three rail terminals at Paddington, Euston and King's Cross with the centre of the city at Farringdon. It was not conceived as a steam railway. The initial suggestion by the Met's chief engineer, John Fowler, had been to have the new underground railway running on compressed air. The idea was that the trains would be blown through the tunnels and sucked back by air generated in great compressors at each end of the line. But the major flaw in this system was that the compressed air leaked all the time through the tunnel joints. With the failure of the system, the Metropolitan Railway was forced to borrow steam locomotives and rolling stock from the Great Western Railway in order to start its service. But despite the steam, it was an immediate success. The system carried 40,000 passengers on its first day. The timetable ran between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. with a train every 15 minutes. The time for the 3.25 mile journey from Paddington to Farringdon was 18 minutes, stopping at all stations. That's not much slower than the journey time now. This newly built railway also had one oddity when it started.
When the Metropolitan Railway was first opened, it had been constructed with both 7-foot gauge, which was Brunel's Great Western Railway broad gauge, because it met end-on with the Great Western Railway at the Paddington end, and it had a third rail added, which also created a 4-foot, 8.5-inch gauge track. That's Stevenson gauge.
The gauge is the distance between the two running tracks. This odd twin gauge arrangement ended when the two companies, the Met and the Great Western Railway, fell out with each other. The Met went back to using Stevenson's gauge, and this is still used by most railways today. Without the locomotives from the Great Western, the Met was forced into supplying its own rolling stock, and for this they turned to the engineering company, Bayer Peacock.
The engine was a 440 tank engine. 440 is the wheel arrangement also used on the standard American engines of the time. And it had fairly large driving wheels, as a passenger engine at the time would have, and a very, very handsome beast. Very successful, used throughout the whole 40-year period of steam on the Metropolitan Railway.
The engines weighed about 46 tonnes. In running order, they could carry approximately 1,000 gallons of water in their tanks, and the couplet driving wheels were 5 feet 9 inches in diameter, driven by two 17-inch cylinders. These are the original coaches that were used in London in the 19th century. They've been carefully restored by a railway preservation society, and each year they're exhibited by enthusiasts to see how they performed. The dreadnoughts, as these carriages are known, were divided according to class.
The fares charged to passengers on the Metropolitan Railway would have been according to the class they travelled in. First class would have been used by top city people travelling to their offices from their fashionable West London homes. Second class would have been used probably by the middle level of management, clerks and so on. And third class, anybody else who needed to travel. And they would have travelled fairly uncomfortably and in very cramped conditions on wooden boards.
The success of the Metropolitan encouraged other companies to start up. And in 1874, London's second underground railway began running along the Thames embankment. This was the Metropolitan and District Railway. By 1884, a complete circular railway had been constructed as a joint venture by the Metropolitan and the District Railway. They called it the Circle Line. And it's still in use today, carrying passengers in its shallow tunnels just beneath Big Ben and the Tower of London. But as the 19th century closed, the new century would bring a new technology.
The use of steam locomotives on underground railways, particularly on the Metropolitan Railway and on the District Railway and some others, became increasingly problematical as time went on. The intensity of the service increased, the intervals between the trains shortened, and passengers were increasingly aggravated by the terrible pollution conditions which existed down there. At the same time, there were technological advances which were occurring in America, for example, and in Germany particularly, in electric traction.
With electrification, the underground system was able to expand, but the extremely expensive cut and cover method no longer seemed an option for building the railways. London just could not cope with the chaos to its roads, and so a new type of underground construction was needed. This was going to take the builders deep into the London clay.
This is a standard London Underground running tunnel, manufactured out of cast iron lining rings. And this slightly larger section of tunnel that we're standing in is called a shield chamber. This is where the Great Head Shield, the device used to help build London's underground railways, was constructed and then dismantled.
A South African engineer called James Henry Greathead invented a thing called a tunnelling shield. It was a kind of iron cylinder with a wall in which miners could actually work in safety in all the soft ground. The earth would be dug out in front of the tunnelling shield, and when a hole large enough had been constructed, the device could be pushed forward. The tunnel lining could then be erected behind the shield to hold the ground up, and then the process repeated.
The Great Head Tunnelling Shield allowed London Underground system to expand into a deep level network. The shield was the single most important engineering invention used to create the underground system. London, at the end of the 19th century, was filled with exciting transport innovations. Permission had been granted to a number of railway companies who were proposing deep level underground routes. But the City and South London Railway was the first to make history. In 1890, it became the first electric underground railway line in the whole world.
The decision to actually use electric traction was a really ambitious thing to do at the time, because most electric traction systems that were in use were tramways. Getting the electrical equipment small enough to actually run in a tunnel and powerful enough to move these quite large trains was a big challenge. The only way they could do it was to put all the electrical equipment into a small locomotive. The power station for the line was down at Stockwell. The problems they had were that the distribution of electricity from the power station up and down the line was not very good. So as the locomotives got further and further away from the power station and started to approach the station in the city up at King William Street, they often found that they were completely underpowered. And as the trains struggled to go up and down the hills, occasionally they would grind to a halt completely and all the lights would go out, leaving the passengers stranded in darkness.
The trains had severe technical problems, and their carriages offered little passenger comfort. They were dubbed the Sardine Box Company, or the padded cells, because they were so claustrophobic. But the City Line proved that electricity was the way forward for the underground network. Another electric-powered tube company began operating in 1900, the Central London Railway, and was